Okay, good evening everyone. Welcome to Trolley World Logic for the 9th of April 2016. And just to let everyone know, we do take live calls through the show. Just add the Skype contact Trolley World Logic, send us a quick PM. We'll add you to the call in due course. Please don't call us. As always, just wait for us to add you to the call and just follow the instructions we give you. And like I say, it's quite a depleted panel right now. I think Pumpkin and Kitch will turn up later, but I'll quickly go through the team tonight. Marty, how's it going?
It's going fine, except that Vaughn is giving me a hard time today.
Yeah, I think so it's giving everyone.
It seems like there's some glitch going on there. That's not our fault.
Okay, I can see in the chat room there are some people seeing us, some aren't. So we'll just try and go, as long as we can hear each other, we've got something to go with. Nathan, what's going on?
Not much. Recovering from a long week of work, and I've been looking forward to this for a while, so it's good to be here.
Yeah, and as we discussed before, we usually have an introduction written out, and it's usually our team member who's kind of got the same sort of interest area as the guest, but sadly, Kitch isn't available here to do this one, so I'll have to quickly introduce, and this is totally off the fly, so apologies in advance, just very popular YouTuber, and I think biochemistry is his field, so probably the worst intro ever. And he's got a puppy, so welcome, Concordance.
Hi, good, glad to be here.
Yeah, so just to remember, chat room, we win all arguments tonight. We have a puppy we can bring up on screen, so
that's right.
We're unbeatable tonight. So thanks for coming.
She's going to eat my thumb.
All right. So yeah, thank you very much for taking the time out tonight.
I'm glad to be here.
So as you can see from the trailers, the topic was to be kind of pandemics, epidemics and all that, and how scientists and the media get the information out there. So I think basically what to start, I think it's like, this is something like I was thinking about earlier. What is the actual difference between an epidemic and a pandemic? Be able to enlighten us with that.
So you've got endemic, epidemic, and then sort of pandemic is one class beyond. So endemic means that the number of new cases over a certain period of time is stable. The number of cases isn't going up, it isn't going down, it's constant. And for certain diseases, they're endemic in certain regions, meaning that just we always have it. You know, HIV went from a pandemic where it was expanding in multiple areas, multiple regions, to sort of endemic in most regions, meaning it's just always there and it's kind of stabilized and flattened out. So epidemic is any time that growth rate is increasing. Usually there are some other qualifiers because we don't want to use the term epidemic every time the growth rate is slightly higher than the background. But, you know, you can have areas where disease is common and suddenly there's an expansion and that becomes epidemic. Pandemic, we usually reserve for something where it's epidemic in multiple regions across the globe. The great flu pandemic spread from probably Kansas, Leavenworth, Kansas, to the entire world and potentially infected up to a fourth of the world's population. That's a pandemic, absolutely. Zika is pandemic in the Americas. It might be considered epidemic in some other regions as well. On the other hand, it seems to be declining in the areas where it probably was originally characterized or spread from. Does that answer the question?
Yeah.
Did I get it right?
we're hoping you'll know that. So just to kind of, so who actually classifies, like, when there's an outbreak of a disease, like, is there some sort of official body that classifies as a pandemic, epidemic, or endemic?
No, I mean, that's just a function of math. You know, growth rate equals, or the growth rate equals one, and they do, usually, I think they do yearly updates, but in some cases, if there's a shorter period of time, it makes sense to measure, they do. I think what you might be identifying here as a really important factor is the World Health Organization, okay, which is kind of an outgrowth of the UN and represents sort of every country in the UN tends to participate in World Health Organization activities, sort of the global health community and public health community. In this case, they have declared a, I don't remember the exact term, but it's a global emergency, a global public health emergency. So Zika virus in particular is almost certainly going to end up spreading far beyond the Americas. And again, it was first characterized in Central Africa, in Uganda, which is what it's named for, the Zika forest, which is a word meaning overgrown. So the Zika virus came from Uganda, or that's what it was for, is first characterized. And then we know it went global only very recently through somewhere in the Western Pacific. So in, forget the Tonga or one of those smaller countries, Polynesia. And from there, it seems to have spread most strongly to the Americas. And it's following the mosquito populations. So it's spread through mosquito and Aedes aegypti and possibly albopictus, and it's been found in all of those. But there's still a lot to do to establish it as a public health emergency. There has to be some health consequence that's overwhelming the ability of the health system to respond. And that seems to be the case.
Yeah. Marty or Nathan, you can come in there.
Well, I don't know anything about the subject, so I can't, like I said before, I don't know enough about this stuff to even have any intelligent questions to ask.
Well, I wrote a blog article about the Zika virus, kind of, obviously I approached it as a layman, but just doing my own research into some of the bogus claims about Zika and the conspiracies around it, and
Hang on. Let's start with what are the conspiracies about it, because I haven't even heard this stuff.
So there's a conspiracy theory going around that implies that the British biotech company Oxitec intentionally or unintentionally, depending on who you talk to, created the Zika virus through their GM mosquitoes that they release in the test areas in South America. And then, of course, Monsanto was brought into it more recently than that, saying that the pesticides they used to fortify or protect the water supplies created the Zika virus and that the mosquitoes aren't even responsible. So, and then there's another one, is that the Tdap vaccine is responsible for the Zika virus. So from what it sounds like, Alex Jones says that Bill Gates is developed the Zika virus for depopulation, but from what it sounds like, if
because then more people will buy Microsoft products. Well, what?
Well, besides that, if an evil genius wanted to reduce the population, the Zika virus is one of the most ineffective ways to do it. It seems to me, because it doesn't take much to protect yourself. Spray mosquito repellent on yourself, you know, and you're pretty much covered.
Okay, you were in the middle of a question there, Nathan, before you.
I was in the middle of a question?
Yeah,
you're talking about the conspiracy theories.
Yeah. You were talking
about... I interrupted you to ask about the conspiracy theory.
Yeah.
I was just making a point about these health scares that are tied into conspiracy theories. The one thing they seem to miss or not take into account is that there are very clear guidelines for what to do to protect yourself from the Zika virus. The WHO and the CDC have very simple, very easy to follow preventive measures on their websites, which kind of, I don't know, does away with the idea that there's a conspiracy by some higher power in government to voice this on people, to make them sick.
So can we go there for just a minute?
Yeah,
I pulled up on the CDC website what your, if you're traveling abroad, what your Zika defense kit should contain. All right, and we'll maybe go through these and talk about it a little bit. It should contain a bed net. So it's a mosquito-borne virus. That's pretty obvious why you'd need a net over your bed so when you sleep at night in a country that is known to be epidemic or endemic for Zika. Insect repellent, just like you said. DEET is always recommended. Permethrin spray, which is also recommended for sort of areas around you, for your skin, you know, deep woods off works fine. Standing water treatment tabs, and those are the mosquito dunks. Have you guys ever used those?
I think I've used them, but for a different purpose. That's kind of just, it sterilizes kind of any stagnant water or stuff like that.
No. These are, actually, they look like someone got cardboard wet, mashed it up, and then sort of shaped it into a loaf, okay. Or a little ring.
Right.
And what it is, it's basically what it is, a cellulose with Bacillus thuringiensis in it, which is a bacteria that destroys, it's BT. It's they're sort of transgenics all about when they do BT corn. This is something that's non-specifically going to kill all insects. And the goal is you toss it into any standing water, and then the water becomes full of this BT bacteria. And I'm sure that would freak out a lot of people if they really knew how it worked. And then that destroys any mosquitoes that drink that water or lay their eggs in that water.
Right.
So it's a good way to treat water near you that could potentially be a breeding ground for mosquitoes. And then they recommend that the last two are a little bit more unusual, a thermometer and condoms. So why would you need a thermometer and condoms?
Well, the only reason I could think of for a thermometer is to check your own temperature and I'll let the other guys
and
guess.
Condoms are pretty self-explanatory, I think.
Well, there is some evidence, isn't there, that the Zika virus can be transmitted through sex.
Yeah. Yes. In fact, that evidence is quite strong. We've taken sperm from infected people, and the interesting thing is, months after the infection, the virus is still at low-level replication in semen. So even someone who is not actively infected, who doesn't have any symptoms, they could potentially be infectious. And obviously that's more of a concern since the primary disease causation that we're concerned about, and maybe we should just talk about that real briefly, is that Zika is not, it's not Ebola, guys. It doesn't cause hemorrhagic disease. To my knowledge, no one has died from it. It's, in fact, one of the more challenging things is that it's relatively benign. It causes, you know, rash and fever and aches, but you probably wouldn't know that you had it unless you had item number, whatever that is, 6, which is a thermometer, which is why you're supposed to monitor to see if you do indeed have a fever. So Zika is so relatively benign that the biggest concern is that you would be unknowingly infected.
Yeah.
And the only expression, the only way we would know is in a pregnant woman, she could potentially have a baby with microcephaly or because she could have a spontaneous abortion. So the condom is to prevent pregnancy or to prevent sexually transmitting the disease, and the thermometers so that people know if they are infected. And it's interesting that it's necessary to even monitor that. Otherwise, you might not know. What do you guys think of that?
Very interesting. So on the scale, how deadly is Zika, like, say, compared to some of the more previous ones, like you know, Ebola or bird flu and all those? Is it really that severe if you were to contract it?
It's completely benign. Again, zero deaths to my knowledge. So there's no risk of you clutching at your throat, gasping as and blood comes out your eyeballs and through your nose. It's not that kind of virus. You would rather have Zika, I think, than the flu.
Yeah.
By a lot, right? Unless something changes about the virus, the risk it poses is only to pregnant women. And that's not always made clear, right? You see a dozen headlines, and it sounds like a scary virus. And in fact, it is an epidemic virus, and the rates are through the roof. This is a virus that's only been on the scene for a few years, and already it's got millions of people who suddenly test positive for it. Yeah. It's also a brief infection. It's not the kind of thing you're carrying around for months later, except potentially in your semen, which is kind of interesting. You probably get it, and then you start having symptoms a few days later. So there's a short, silent period. And then you have it for a couple of days, and it's gone, which creates another issue for understanding the kinetics of the virus. You have to basically catch the pregnant mom when she's shedding virus in order to know if she's actually been exposed. Right? One of the other challenges is, how do we know that someone actually has been exposed to a virus? What do you guys know about diagnostics on detecting whether or not someone's been infected?
Okay. This
How
is
do you think they do it?
They have to do like a...
So blood tests would be the...
Yeah, blood tests or something like that.
Yeah.
So what are they looking for in the blood, do you think? This turns out to be a really big issue.
The naive thing would be to say viruses, but I guess it's not that simple.
Well, and the viruses are only there for a few days, right? So we might only pick up viruses for 2 or 3 or 4 days. And if you're monitoring a pregnant woman 6 months later, right, she might have had it. And again, remember, it's asymptomatic half the time. So she might have had a slight fever. She might have had a rash. Could be anything, right? It's dozens of diseases that we just barely notice in any given moment. So we don't know if a woman's been exposed by detecting virus. The only way we can detect whether or not she's been exposed is, does she have antibodies to the virus?
Okay.
Well, that's problematic because she's going to have viruses from the moment she's infected forward. We don't know if she was infected before she was pregnant. We also have the big issue that Zika virus is very, very similar to a lot of other filoviruses. So if you test someone who lives in Brazil, they will have been exposed to a lot of closely related viruses. They're going to have antibodies to those viruses almost certainly, right? And then now you're testing people and you're saying, yes, they're antibody positive. They're seropositive is the proper term. But we don't know if that means they were exposed when they were 15, if they were exposed, you know, the day they became pregnant or midway through their pregnancy, where it might be a possible risk. So trying to untangle all of this has been really challenging because we rarely catch the virus in the act of doing what it's doing. And so all we can do is sort of say, look, there's a correlation between people who have antibodies, which might indicate that they were infected at some point in their lives for something like Zika, and the sudden increase in microcephaly, which is the manifestation of Zika virus-induced birth defects. So the media reports this as this sort of, you know, very confident, we know that there's a link, or they sort of play word games with it, you know, has been associated with, is linked to, which is technically correct, but doesn't tell the whole story.
I would ask that, like, you know, because if you watch the news report, I'm seeing people, you know, I'm hearing people saying, no, I'm not, you know, about the Olympics are in threat because of this, and, you know, there's all these sports events, oh, nothing will be happening, and I was just wondering, I mean, it is the same old story, they want the big scary headline, because if they explained it, if the headline was, as you said, it's very mild, it'll go away in a few days, and there's a slight risk of this, that's not going to make people turn their heads and watch the TV screen.
It's very hard to present certainty in any subject that's this recent. But the news headlines aren't interesting when they're scientifically accurate. To say, you know, possible association with, even then, when they are scientifically accurate, I think most people don't have the scientific literacy to understand what level of uncertainty we're actually at this point. you know, I made a prediction early on when it was first launched out. They had this strong sense of certainty that it would turn out to be a lot more complex, or it wouldn't end up being associated with Zika. It's unlikely, I think, that it would be an unusual situation. Yeah. That a virus would cause a neural tube defect like this, that it would cause something that altered brain expression. What we do know causes changes in neural tube during development are chemicals. And Brazil is an area where environmental health and ecology are not robustly enforced. It seemed more likely to me that the Zika virus was one of many possible risk factors, but not the primary driver. And I still maintain that that's possible, which is why when these conspiracy theories came out, I'll be honest, some of them occurred to me as at least plausible. Not the GMO theory, I'm not at all worried about that because I know too much about it, but the idea that a larvicide or an insecticide could potentially cause neural tube defect or microcephaly specifically, combined with the fact that the more you look for a disease, the more likely you are to find it, right? And that's always a concern. If you start a panic and everyone is suddenly hyper-vigilant for anything close to microcephaly, which is defined very broadly as a baby born in the lowest 1% of head size, right? There would be severe cases which would actually be flagrant microcephaly. And then you'd have children with just smaller heads. I mean, by random distribution, you would expect some children to be near that 1% level just from random chance.
It's interesting you say, because we have someone in the chat room who came up and he's saying, I'd rather have the flu than something that would prevent me from ever having healthy children. It's quite interesting to get that kind of reaction to it, because that in any way accurate what he's kind of saying there?
Not really. No, it would be a matter of months. It wouldn't be for life. It would be a matter, and that's what they're recommending, is that people not have sex if they have been to a country where the Zika epidemic is active. For a period of months afterwards, that they use barrier contraception in the same way you might for, you know, herpes or HIV. You want to make sure you're using a proper barrier method. And that's led to some interesting, we can maybe talk about the Catholic Church and the discussions that are being had there. But
oh, here we go.
Yeah. Well, there's been some back and forth, but it wouldn't be for life. It would be for a period of a few months after travel. And that's because right now the U.S., most of Europe, is safe from being primary spread. There's still some imported cases that are popping up. And we're a little concerned about the Gulf Coast region in the U.S. and probably parts of Southern Europe would be at risk. Anywhere the vector species exists, Aedes aegypti is found, is going to be where the virus is going to go. And we humans have done a really good job of moving it around with us, so that there's probably anywhere that's tropical and wet is a risk of Aedes aegypti. In the U.S., we spend a lot of effort and money on spraying to prevent them. So this is really, it's a viral disease, but it's so tied to the mosquito that wherever the mosquitoes are is where the disease is going to be.
I'm hearing a lot of well thought out, reasonable, you know, don't be worried by the fear mongering and all that there. But I honestly find that hard to believe, because the Daily Mail has assured me that Zika is being brought in by foreigners and the virus itself is going to steal our jobs, take our dole money and turn us into a communist state. And you're not a newspaper, so... But it is definitely interesting, sort of the double-edged sword, as you were saying, that when lots of people are looking for it, the more likely to find it, which kind of gives it the double-edged sword of, yes, it's fear-mongering, you don't need to buy into the bullshit, but buy into it just enough to pay attention.
You know, there's a very important principle here, and it's often misused, and I think it will be misused here as well. You guys are familiar with the precautionary principle?
Yeah, that's basically, if there's any risk, then it's not worth doing, basically. That's kind of a...
Kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the burden of proof is on proving that it's safe,
okay,
not proving that it's harmful. Right, totally. So we start with the assumption that anything that can cause harm does cause harm. And then the necessity is then on the part of those who want to validate that it is indeed safe. Right, and it's often used by opponents of GMO to say that, look, it's not the assumption that just because there's a single base pair difference that it isn't causing cancer and autism and people's heads to spontaneously explode. It's on the burden of proof is on Monsanto or the GMO company to prove that it is indeed safe.
Again. Because you can prove it once and twice and three times, but it's never going to be enough.
Right. And vaccines don't cause autism, et cetera, et cetera. The assumption is that they must, right?
Yeah.
And that's not really a valid interpretation, I think. But that's sort of also a good operating principle for public health. You should assume that something that could cause disease is causing disease until it can be proven not to. But the approach is different. The conclusions are different than I think the GMO opponents and anti-vax people are sort of drawing it out to be. We should have an abundance of caution. And if you look at the early government press releases, not so much the government of Brazil, which was sort of alarmist from the very beginning, but the CDC, the WHO, the sort of responsible health agencies, we're saying, look, if you're a pregnant woman and you're in Brazil or you're thinking of traveling to Brazil, these are the precautions you absolutely should take until we're certain that this is something that can be prevented, until we have a diagnostic test, until we have a therapeutic or a vaccine. Why don't you keep the mosquito spray handy or reschedule your travel, right? So that was taken by the news agencies and turned into these very kind of alarmist reports. You know, pregnant women, CDC advises pregnant women not travel to Brazil, which, again, if we're doing abundance of caution because we don't yet know, the burden of proof would be on proving it's safe. That would mean that we would err on the side of caution every time. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Same thing with, you know, Ebola. We ended up making people prisoners of their own homes because we weren't quite sure how fast it would spread or what kind of casual contact would be necessary for proper quarantine. And a lot of it was overreaction, right? People were stockpiling duct tape and plastic in case they had to, you know, tape over their windows to keep the airborne virus out. And that's, I think, going to sell more newspapers or drive more traffic to your website, but it's not actually what the intention of the public health community was.
Yeah. Okay, I say we've got a caller waiting, but we do have some chat room questions to get to first. So, Pumpkin, as always, it's usually the last or the person who's spoken the least to go with the chat room question, so take it away.
Yay, I showed up late. question from Microblogonism. Considering, could the similarity with Zika make it easier for, I don't know, could that similarity make it easier to make vaccines for flaviria?
Flaviviruses, yes.
Yeah, in general, once we could figure out how to make that one for them, make one for them.
Yeah, probably not, actually. And this relates to other flaviviruses. When you have an antibody against a virus, it has to neutralize that virus. It has to stick to it so completely that the virus is rendered inactive. Anything that binds to the virus partly or in the wrong regions could potentially accelerate its disease progression by making it be taken up by immune cells more rapidly. And that's a known phenomenon where improper, incomplete vaccination or immunity actually accelerates disease progression. Your immune system can also overreact. So one of the things that Zika virus has also been linked to is Guillain-Barré syndrome, which is an autoimmune disease where your body, kind of like an MS, it attacks the myelin sheath that coats the ends of your neurons to make sure that the electrical conduction works properly. If you have a non-specific immune reaction because you vaccinated against the wrong thing, it's possible to produce antibodies which stimulate more Guillain-Barré syndrome or autoimmunity, or simply make the virus a whole lot worse because you're making the kinetics of it a lot faster. Probably not a major risk, but it also is a concern. Any vaccine we make has to be completely neutralizing. So I think the bigger concern is actually cross-reactivity, right? Having a vaccine that ends up causing other diseases to become more pathogenic, because there's a lot of nasty ones in the flavivirus family that are more concern than Zika.
Okay, Pumpkin, there was one more chat room question, and after that we'll go to the caller.
Okay. Caller, you might want to mute the stream.
Is this one from Poison Dosage?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, Daniel, can you mute your Vaughn stream? Because we're getting a bit of an echo coming back.
Yes, you are a terrible, terrible person. another question here from Poison Dosage, and I would like to thank the chat for making ridiculously hard to say questions. You're a bunch of bastards. Would there
it's
be a
not
potential...
their fault that you're an idiot.
Oh, fuck off. Swedish, Norwegian, Danish bastard. Would there be a potential of correlating antibody titer level and potential plasma versus memory cell ratio to sort of get a standard curve for possible exposure period? Boom! Fuck you, I feel proud for that.
with really big error bars, yes. What he's asking is, can you tell from the state of the immune system how long ago the person was exposed? And I think the answer is, you could tell if it's very recent or not very recent. And so you get these big error bars, and it's not diagnostically all that useful. And the problem is that once the antibodies are made, you know, with again, whether you're 15 or 18 or 21, 8 years ago, it doesn't matter. The one thing we have working for us here is that we know that Zika is very new to the Americas, so we can sort of discount the idea that people have these long-term infections. There, the big problem is not long-term. We're infected a long time ago. Again, the problem is that there are other flaviviruses that are endemic in Brazil, and the antibodies cross-react almost 100%. So that's made it really challenging to know if the person's actually been exposed to these other viruses.
So can I just a quick question? Flavivirus, that's basically the same family of or same that's type? Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. They're probably closely related, everything in flavivirus. I think flavi, and I could be wrong here, is Latin for yellow. And that's because the type virus for this was yellow fever.
Okay.
Yellow fever is, I think, really kind of raised awareness of yellow fever when they were digging the Panama Canal. Teddy Roosevelt days, 1910s, I guess. And they kept coming down with this disease they later called yellow fever. And they're almost all arbovirus. They're all arthropod-born infections. They're all transmitted by mosquitoes or other arthropods. And quite a few of them are pretty nasty. They're almost all tropical diseases.
And with that, excuse me, we can go to our caller. He's been very patiently waiting. Daniel, are you there?
Absolutely.
All right,
it's a pleasure talking to you today.
Oh, it's no problem. Thanks for the call. You're on with Concordance. Ask your question.
I was wondering, historically speaking, when it comes to epidemics and people being exposed to these viruses, over a period of time, survivability goes up and mortality rates go down. Is it possible that we can speculate on a more optimistic stance when it comes to Zika? And how have definitions of epidemics changed when it comes to modern media, when it comes to the obesity epidemic and the autism epidemic?
Ooh, good questions. First off, let me remind everyone that Zika virus is extremely mild and benign, except in pregnant women. No one cares about Zika. It was discovered back in the 40s, okay? We've known about this virus for decades, and no one cared about it. It was a little brother of a bunch of other viruses, because half the people who got it didn't even know they had it. It's, you know, a fever and a sore throat. I think I'd rather have Zika than, you know, norovirus or something that makes me spew at both ends. It's not that bad a virus. So it probably has been in primates for a long time. As you say, it's usually an indicator of how long the virus has adapted to its host organism. Over time, there's always pressure to either make the victim of the virus, and I'm talking here about evolution of viruses. There's either a pressure to make someone extremely pathogenic, that is, they just become a fountain of viruses shooting it out against the walls, right? And the strategy of the virus there is to infect as many other people as possible in a shorter period of time. But those tend to burn themselves out. If you cause a lot of disease, you're oozing out every pore, you've got blood shooting out the eyeballs, that person's going to die, and in a sparse population, they're not going to have time to make it to the next village over in order to start the infection cycle over again, right? So over time, most viruses are pressured to become long-term viruses, and that manifests itself as less and less disease states. You know, instead of blood coming out the nose, you get a puffy nose, right? Instead of bleeding, you just get swelling in the nasal cavity. And then you start sneezing the virus out. Well, that's great, because that person then has, you know, 10 years to live with this horrible virus. And then they're definitely making the trip to the next village over. And those people are starting the infection cycle over. And the virus is happy because it's spreading all over the world, right? So over time, there's a tendency of viruses to become less pathogenic as they adapt to their host. They spend more time evading the immune system than triggering an immune response. And the nirvana for a virus is to become something that a mother gives to its child, or eventually to become part of the genome that gets drug around. And, you know, that's the armchair and a beer for a virus. It's just, it doesn't have to do anything. It's getting replicated along with the host organism. So could we optimistically hope that something like Zika will become even less pathogenic? Yeah, but at this point, it's not pathogenic. And that is one of the risks, is that people who don't know that they're infected could potentially spread the disease a lot more. I would say that viruses like the flaviviruses, all arboviruses, are much more tied to the mosquito population. And we've done them such a favor in moving water around for them. One of the biggest vectors for the spread of mosquitoes has been the used tire industry, right? Those used tires are perfect receptacles for the Aedes aegypti and Aedes genus of mosquitoes, because it's clear water, it's dark spots, and those mosquitoes lay their eggs. We move the tires around, they get rained on, and they harbor the virus, and then you get this massive bloom of virus. So I think the best thing we could do is to minimize or eliminate as many mosquito populations as possible, and eliminate the places where they breed. And the other half of the question was, can you remind me?
How has the definition of epidemic changed when it comes to the obesity epidemic and the autism epidemic? And as the way we've diagnosed things, we've increased the spectrum of autism and the spectrum of what BMI constitutes as obese. Is there any equivalent in the real virus world?
Yeah, I know that the term epidemic is thrown around a lot. You know, HIV at this point is not a pandemic per se, because it's pretty stable. The populations over time have not changed much. So calling it an epidemic is probably inappropriate. The rates are fairly stable. I think we use the term because people think epidemic as, you know, outbreak. Any kind of outbreak is an epidemic. But I don't know, in popular media, it doesn't really matter if they're using the terminology correctly. I don't really have a strong response to that.
It kind of does, because people come across the word in popular media, and then they come across the word in the scientific context, and they equivocate. So I think it's true that obesity is increasing,
right? There are more people with obesity in the U.S., probably every year. I don't know. It may have gone down in some years. So if the rate's increasing, it is properly an epidemic. The same thing's true for autism. And you identified something really important. There were some changes to the diagnostic criteria. So that probably accounts for a large portion of the increase, but possibly not all of it. And there's some other factors that are probably in play as well. So if we call it an epidemic, does that confuse people to think that it's an infectious issue, or do people have the know-how to know that it just means an increase in the prevalence?
I suspect that people get that impression that it's, I mean, when you look at autism, that's a perfect example. People are looking for things that cause autism. I don't think anyone believes that it can pass from person to person, except perhaps from parent to child. But people are definitely under the impression that there are things you do, like depending on, you know, what you eat, if you have vaccines, stuff like that, that can cause autism. And then the word epidemic seems to suggest that, something is causing this to increase.
It definitely has an emotional component to it.
Yeah, exactly.
One thing I would say, and this is a terrible pun, but fuck it. I think it's fair to say that obesity is an epidemic because it's constantly increasing. The volume of people is just constantly increasing.
Sure.
A shit pun, and I'm proud of it.
It's also true, though, that people are more fit than they have been in the past. And that seems like it's completely contradictory. But people are exercising more than they did in the 80s and 90s. And in fact, the rates of heart disease, depending on how you normalize and age adjust, can be seen to go down, even though obesity is going up. So people are getting fatter, but they're healthier.
If memory serves,
crazy.
A lot of... Some of the older methods of saying whether someone's obese is basically just put them on a scale, get their height, their age, and how heavy they are. Muscle weighs a lot more than fat, so if you're a muscular guy, you're apparently obese, even though you have no fat on you at all.
But you would think that wouldn't be most of the population. I mean, you can look around at a Walmart or a chain restaurant and see that, people are pretty heavy and not in muscle.
I get that. But kind of when you have enough extraneous variables tossed on, they start becoming interfering more. But definitely, I think it's just has more to do with the ease of access for food, the low cost of it, and, you know, the fact that food's fucking tasty.
Okay, Daniel, do you have anything else for us there?
Only that I'm a big fan. Thank you so much for taking my call, gentlemen.
Okay, not a problem. Thanks for having you along.
Oh, you big tease.
Okay.
You know, I have prepared this little game. Do you guys want to go through my virus or not?
Yeah, we'll call the chat.
Kitsch doesn't seem to be showing up anytime soon.
Yeah.
let's stall for time, though, with it.
Yes.
So I've got a group of non-virologists here, right?
Yes,
we do. No one's going to cheat.
But
I'm not even a scientist, so...
We do have some in the chat room, so we might get some help. We can ask the audience.
Okay, that's fine. That's fine. So I've got a list of real and fake viruses. Okay. And some of these, I was trying to stall on mentioning their names so you guys wouldn't know if they were real or fake earlier in discussing flaviviruses. So I'm going to list them off, give you a second to say real or not. Okay? So we'll start with an easy one, monkeypox.
Real.
Real or fake?
I think that's real.
Real.
Absolutely, real.
Yay! Yeah.
If it can happen to chickens, it can happen to monkeys.
Poison dosage, right. Got it wrong.
What about question two? Green man virus.
I'm going to go fake.
Fake.
You think I'm going to alternate? That's what you think.
No, not consistently, but I think you're doing that in this case.
Pumpkin, your answer.
I said real at the very beginning.
Okay, and Nathan?
I said real as well.
That's a reference to It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, and no, there's no Green Man virus. Yes. But it sounds like a real name.
Yeah, it sounds like more of a colloquial term for one.
Yeah.
So I'm going to take that as a win anyway, even though it isn't. Gangrene is officially Green Man virus.
Right.
That's not even a virus.
Right. Or is it the clap you get from having sex with aliens, maybe?
I have to ask Lindy about that one.
That would be Kirk virus.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Three. Dengue virus.
Real.
I'm going to say real because I think I've heard of that one.
I've heard the name too, or there's something that sounds very similar.
Yeah. It's real.
I'm going to say real.
Real.
Very real. Oh, and in fact, dengue virus is the one that Zika virus resembles most closely. And so dengue is, I believe, the most prevalent virus infection on Earth in humans. So more people have dengue virus than flu. In Vietnam, I think this year there were something like 2 or 3 million cases. It's often called bone break fever because when you get it, you get these aches and chills and you feel like your bones are breaking. So it's a very painful, very unpleasant experience. People know when they've had dengue. The thing about dengue is if you're cross-infected from one serotype to another, in other words, if you live in Costa Rica and you get the African version of dengue, you get dengue hemorrhagic fever. Hemorrhagic, as you might imagine, means you're bleeding out places you shouldn't be bleeding, and potentially without really intensive support, without being, IV fluids in a hospital bed, the case fatality rate is quite high. So dengue is extremely endemic in the last 10 years in Brazil. So something like 40% of the population have antibodies against dengue, which means they also react against Zika. So it's the one that's causing us the most trouble when we're trying to do any kind of diagnostic testing for Zika.
So
it's also got a silly name.
One of the forms of it means you feel like all of your bones are breaking and you're shedding blood. Awesome.
Yes. Do not want to get. Also, of course, mosquito borne. Okay. All right. Here's another one.
Carry on.
We're on question what number four here?
Yep.
Chikungunya.
Real.
I'm going to go fake.
Yeah, I'll go fake this time.
Fake.
Very real.
Oh.
Fuck you.
And also closely related to both dengue and to Zika. Okay. Much more mild form than dengue. It's also, we are under an epidemic of chikungunya. So it's spreading across the Americas. It's already in Africa, anywhere tropical Africa. It's quite common and growing. So that's why we have an epidemic chikungunya. If you go to a country near the equator, you'll see warnings when you board the plane about, please use mosquito control. We're trying to deal with chikungunya infections and so on. It's intermediate between Zika and dengue. It's unpleasant, but not terrible. And I think the case fatality rate is extremely low, except in the elderly and children. All right. Next this one. This one's gonna be tricky. This is, I think, five now. Coxsackievirus.
Okay, that sounds like a genre of very strange porn.
Coxsackievirus.
Fake.
I think it sounds so crazy that it has to be real.
That's exactly what I was thinking. I'm going to go with real, too.
It's absolutely real. And it's named for Coxsackie, New York, where it was first characterized. It is the main source of a form of meningitis that doesn't involve bacteria, aseptic meningitis. So it has a pretty high death toll, and it's a nasty one, and it's found all over. So Coxsackie virus is it's an odd name, but it's because the city it's named from is also an odd name.
Nope, it's just named after a weird fetish, I'm sure.
All right, let's see if you guys can just catch the contrast here. Balchinian virus.
That has to be fake.
Yeah, I'm going fake again.
Fake.
All right, that's fake. You guys are too good.
Yeah, come on, don't bring your Men in Black references here.
You guys would catch that. All right, dum-dum virus.
Real.
Oh, it's going to be a tricky one.
I think
real.
Yeah, I'm going to go with real.
That's fake. I checked. I double checked because it does sound like your real virus.
Oh. Yeah, it does.
All right, I've lost count of how many I've done now. Right. Astrovirus. Astrovirus. Really? Might cause space madness.
Fake.
Astrovirus. No, I'm going to say fake.
Fake.
Yeah, fake.
Okay, that's actually real.
Oh,
what the fuck?
It's a class of viruses, including Norwalk virus and some other ones that cause really nasty diarrhea, the ones that tend to show up on cruise ships, people overloading their toilet and so on. The reason it's called astroviruses is because
you shit so much you take off into space. Is that it?
I think madness. This is kind of cheating, though, because you said we were talking about viruses, not groups of viruses.
So I'm sorry.
You're a terrible person, and you should feel bad.
But the reason it's called astrovirus is because the virus under an electron microscope is star-shaped.
Okay.
Right, yeah. So they said, the star viruses. What about this one? This one's going to be just testing trivia. Hepatitis E as an echo.
True. Or real. Fuck
it. Yeah, real.
Well, I'm going to have to stand out and say fake.
That's actually real. Hepatitis E really does. It's one of the... I mean, obviously, they're A through E now. Hepatitis A is a foodborne infection. Hepatitis B and C tend to be bloodborne. And then there's E, which is kind of a cofactor virus. So... I got one last one here, and it's maybe the hardest one for you. Easter Island virus. Name for a real place.
I'm going to go real.
Yeah, I know Easter Island is a real place, but I don't know if there's a virus there, but I'm going to say real.
Real.
Big.
Yeah, that's a 50-50, right? I mean, it could be either way. Yeah. But no, that I made that one up.
Okay.
What about one last one? We'll make this the bonus question. C0nc0rdance virus. C0nc0rdance is Spanish for without a name. The virus without a name.
I would actually say real.
Real.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah,
I shouldn't have used actual Spanish. Yes, it's real. That's the name for hantavirus that's found in the U.S. It was originally called the Four Corners virus, but the people of the Four Corners region of the U.S., which is largely made of Indian reservations, Native American reservation, objected to it being named for their region, And so after much debating, they decided, fine, this is the virus without a name, it's sin nombre. So that's a version of Hanta pulmonary virus.
I would have voted Voldemort virus.
And with that, we can welcome Kitch, and no one's actually watching us right now, and that's not in a bad way, but there's some technical issues with Vaughn as far as I can see. Says at my
I was wondering what's going on, because Vaughn kind of stalled on me, and also, yeah. Hey, but guys, sorry I'm late. I had some footballing matters to attend to.
I can see everyone entering and entering the room, so I've no idea. We can just carry on with the discussion. If it comes back, then we'll speak to you.
Sure, we can always upload it online.
Yeah. So, Kitch, like, as you've come in, you probably had some questions pre-prepared, so we can... I hope you did, anyway.
I was just thinking, where did I leave them? Because I worked on them in work. Now, if I left them at work, that'd be classic me.
Yes, probably would be.
These look science questions.
For a second, I thought Kitch was talking about viruses he'd made. It's like, oh shit, I forgot to take them with me on the bus.
Can I, while we're stalling for time, can I throw out a little bit of a comparison? In terms of human cost of viruses, I think it's often completely out of proportion. And we're talking about reporting. Would that be all right? Can I go down that path?
Yeah, that's fine.
So I want to give you a sense in the estimates that are currently present. They're estimating about 2,500 cases of microcephaly in Brazil. And just a handful in the rest of the world, which is a real head scratcher, why it isn't causing more microcephaly outside of Brazil. And I think that's probably one of the puzzles that the scientists really have yet to solve. But I want to give some sense of proportion. 2,500 children born with microcephaly, and every one of those children is a tragedy. It's a horrible, horrible thing for a parent to have to take care of a child that is not going to be developmentally normal, will have, you know, intensive medical needs for the rest of their life. But I want to put the 2,500...
Can I just interrupt here and ask about microcephaly? I mean, I know it means that the head is very small, but, like, to use the politically incorrect terminology here, because I don't know what the PC version of it is this week, are these kids retarded, or is it like, okay, they have small heads, you know?
No, they're missing huge chunks of their brain. I mean,
they're
dependent on medical care for the rest of their lives.
So it's not even just that they are not of normal intelligence. There are actual functions that are not working.
Yeah, they're missing, you know, 60% of their neurons. So they're never going to have a normal life. Yeah. You know, again, I'm sure people will love them and care for them and bring joy into someone's life, I suppose. But they're also going to be a real challenge for any parent who has to cope with that. And, of course, anytime there's any kind of behavioral element, they have to cope with the guilt of not getting tested or... You know, it's just going to be a huge mess. But just I want to put it in a little bit of perspective, not to trivialize the 2,500 families who are going to be affected, but just to give you a sense of proportion. Measles, in I think it's 2014 is the number I'm looking at here, killed 145,000 children in 2014. Yeah. That's 145,000 deaths in children from a disease that is preventable by vaccines, currently preventable. And if that doesn't just shock the hell out of you, I don't know what would. If we limit ourselves to just something like a congenital condition, something that the mother exposes the baby to in utero, rubella is a classic example. Rubella, which is sometimes called German measles, is something where it's a virus. The mom gets it. If they're pregnant while they have rubella, potentially the child can be born with congenital rubella syndrome, which can produce mental retardation. It can produce any other number of developmental disorders, low birth weight, variable expression. But how many people would you guys think, how many babies born in the world have congenital rubella syndrome? Give me a number. Remember, this is MMR. This is the R in MMR. So it's a vaccine preventable disease.
Like, and the globally vaccine's not are used. Just in the first world or
globally.
Well, it's either going to be really high or really low. So
I'm going to go bet high just to.
Yeah, but I have no idea what high would mean in this case. So I have absolutely no idea.
100,000.
Oh, wow. No reason to keep going after that. It's 100,000.
All right.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, yeah. I am, in fact, that's the god of the world.
Feeding his ego now.
So 2,500 potential microcephaly cases. And again, totally a horrible, horrible scenario. But 100,000 congenital rubella syndrome, CRS, babies. And yet, you know, when we focus on the epidemic, because it's new and because it's growing, we're much more concerned about it, even though the sort of human cost is much higher for measles and rubella, right? Syphilis is even worse. And I won't make you guys guess. In the U.S., we have only about 400 cases of congenital syphilis. This is moms who have syphilis when the baby's born. They have, quite often, they're blind and deaf or both. But it happens at a rate about 10 times what is currently going on with Zika and microcephaly. So in the world, there's a lot higher cases of syphilis that are untreated in pregnant mothers. You've got something like 2 million cases of syphilis at any given time. And about half of those are going to involve mothers or women, and a percentage of those are going to involve pregnant women. So in terms of why we cover Zika the way we do, a lot of people are still under the misconception that Zika is like Ebola and that people are bleeding out their eyeballs and dying, when in fact it's a matter of a few thousand children born with microcephaly, which again, I'm not going to trivialize. But if put in proportion to other similar types of diseases, including the ones that we already have vaccines for, it's odd the way our awareness works about these kinds of diseases. And I think the media feeds into that complete disproportionate idea because we don't know what's going to happen with Zika. It's a fear response, right? I think that's worth kind of highlighting.
I think... from my understanding, it's as much as it's the heartless bastard thing to say. Sometimes you need to be a heartless bastard and say, this is a bigger problem. We should probably be focusing on what we can fix, considering it's hitting more people. Admittedly, you know, work on crushing Zika and everything, but like you said, the just sheer volume of cases of preventable diseases killing kids is fucked. But yeah, I do agree with you that a lot of it has to do with just fear-mongering media, and as much as I joked earlier about the Daily Mail saying it's coming over to steal our jobs and all that shit, it always seems to be that way of, here's this new thing and it's gonna blow up and everyone's gonna die and you're gonna be oozing blood and piss out of your eyeballs and oh, it'll be horrible. Buy next week's newspaper and we'll talk to you about how you can possibly prevent this virus. Ding!
It's all about selling issues at this stage. Not about getting the truth out there. What kind of truth can we sell?
If it bleeds, it leads.
And you know, this has a real impact on how we respond in the science world and the public health world. Obama just signed an act reallocating funds that were dedicated for Ebola towards Zika. And again, to kind of give you a sense of proportion, I've got my numbers up here in front of me. In 2014, there were 28,000 cases of Ebola and 11,000 deaths. And now we're talking about you know, 2,500 cases of microcephaly, which, I don't know, 11,000 deaths are probably less of a burden on the healthcare system than 2,500 cases of microcephaly. But it doesn't seem to be proportionate in how we respond to these things. I also think there's more of a concern that Zika is more likely to end up in the U.S. So we're a little bit more concerned about it. And, you know, the human cost of
it if it's happening over there.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Ebola, we've managed to sort of keep in Africa so far. And there's a very good chance that Florida, at least, and Louisiana here in the U.S., and probably possible for it to show up in southern parts of Europe. I'm not so sure, though. Certainly in North Africa, it's possible. But for the most part, it stays south of the Sahara in Africa. So southern Africa.
Right. Kitch, you can. I was going to say, Kitch, you can take it away. You're the latecomer here.
Zika is easier to travel. It's easier to spread than Ebola.
Pardon me, just a minute, guys.
Okay, well, concordance is gone. I want everyone to take a long, hard look at Kitch's picture of him holding an eagle, pretending to be a badass. What do you look like?
Sorry about that. Phone call.
Okay,
no problem. We're just making polite conversation.
So, I'm sorry, the question was, is it directed to me?
Yes.
I hope so, because I have no idea.
What was the question again?
Is Zika easier or more likely to spread than Ebola in terms of going from one region to another?
Yeah, absolutely. So the method of transmission is so much different. Virus that hitches a ride on mosquito are going to be a lot easier to move around than something that has to be direct contact with body fluids, as in the case of Ebola. It would be a lot easier to put a stop to Zika. The problem with putting a stop to Zika is that you basically have to eliminate the mosquito. Which is not something we're likely to do.
And so obviously best thing to do for Zika would be to employ better mosquito control, such as anti-insect spray, the mosquito nets and all that sort of paraphernalia.
And that will certainly break part of the cycle, but remember, it's also sexually transmitted. And there are questions about whether or not it might be in the blood supply as well. To my knowledge, there hasn't been a confirmed case where it was spread through blood transfusion. But if it does replicate in blood, and if that blood isn't quarantined sufficiently or correctly, then it's possible that someone accepting a transfusion could be infected. It's not like HIV. This is not a virus that's going to stick around for years or more. It's going to be gone in a couple of days. But that's also a concern. So the sexually transmitted side is frustrated by the fact that a lot of South America is devoutly Catholic, and the Catholic Church is sticking to its guns on the idea that we shouldn't abort babies just because, or abort fetuses because they are affected, and B, we shouldn't overreact and start using birth control, which we know is an effective barrier.
I don't know. My personal favorite has always and will always be Pope Benedict, I think it was. I just call him the Hitler Youth. Hitler Youth Pope comes in and says, no, condoms definitely doesn't stop the spread of HIV.
Yeah,
so don't worry about them. Oh, but, fuck, everyone in Africa is getting HIV. I don't know how that could happen.
Bring just weren't praying hard enough, I suppose.
Yeah,
I wish someone would apply a little bit more pressure to the current Pope was I think let's see if I can get the exact quote in my head. He said use of condoms is not an extreme evil. It's not a inherent evil that it's, you know, there might be situations. So that was a softening of his position, where I would much rather he said yes, by all means, control your reproductive rights until you've got a clean Zika test. You know, for people from outside of Brazil, the best thing to do is to use a condom. For people in Brazil, if they're devoutly Catholic, I don't know what to tell you. It's one of the best methods we've got to prevent at least the sexually transmitted method of transmission.
And to sound that,
this is a case where criticism of religion is fair play when it comes to things that impact people's health and lives. Let people have the freedom to believe whatever they want to believe, but when they step into things like preventing disease or actions that will not prevent disease but make it worse, then absolutely go after it and criticize it on that ground.
I know we're Nathan just said that like it's fair play to criticize, but if I start the tangent, dear merciful fuck, I will never end it. And as for Slendy saying in the chat that I just invoked Godwin's law, the dude was a cunt and he was in the Hitler Youth. Fuck him.
You know, the other traditional practice that was problematic, and it still is, I'm sure, was funeral rites in Africa during the Ebola epidemic, which again requires contact with body fluids. You know, professional embalmer, you know, highly trained people, basically, who know how to avoid contact, were using, you know, barrier gloves and masks and are at least aware of contamination protocols. Handling dead bodies are at much lower risk than families who are preparing dead bodies for a funeral. And an investment in, say, you know, even U.S. subsidies for funerals and proper mortuaries would have an impact on the spread of Ebola, potentially outside the area that it's currently contained in. So sometimes a little bit of religious and cultural meddling is necessary. Sometimes it does come across as very heavy-handed, and there's a sort of a fine line, I think, that has to be walked between the public health community and the respecting the rights of people to their culture. You know, a really good example of that was during the early days of the AIDS epidemic in the U.S., where there were, you know, hot spots of infection like the bathhouses, the gay bathhouses, where anonymous and frequent gay sex was probably spreading the virus and causing, again, a lot of human suffering. But there was reluctance to shut that down because it was part of their sexual identity, their culture. And some people still sort of criticize them for making the decisions to close those down.
All I can say is, like, it is always difficult for people to shed that sort of cultural identity of this has been tradition for years, but there's a point when a tradition becomes just too damn dangerous that we know better. And that's why I would like to make this my official announcement for the Monty Python bill, wherein I will personally go to Africa with a cart and say, "Bring out your dead." And that is how I will stop the spread of all these horrible diseases.
You know, one of the questions that comes up a lot.
More seriously, I'm sorry.
One of the questions that comes up a lot is whether or not, if we had the power, we should eliminate mosquitoes from Earth. Wipe them out. Make them eradicated. And, you know, there's a lot of discussion about whether or not they're actually essential to the ecology, whether we should have the right to decide to exterminate a species utterly. We've done it accidentally, but this would be an intentional act. If we did, we would take a lot of diseases out with the mosquitoes. And, you know, there's a lot of work being done, a lot of research being done on whether or not it would be possible to completely eradicate mosquitoes from the earth. Not all mosquitoes, but quite a few species.
Just on that note, something came up. Why are mosquitoes such good carriers of disease? That's understood.
They take blood in, they carry it around, shit like that.
Exactly. Yeah. So they get past our number one barrier against viruses, which is the skin. Right. You know, bees carry pollen. Why are bees so good at carrying pollen? Well, because that's an adaptation that they have made. And the pollen or the plant benefits from it, and so on. It's the same thing. The virus benefits from the mosquito vector, and the mosquito is not harmed by it, so there's really no reason why it wouldn't. And obviously, it's there to gather a blood meal. Did you guys know that mosquitoes don't just drink blood?
No, I didn't know that.
I learned, I mean, a long time ago, but it kind of shocked me, that they don't live on blood. Blood is needed. They need a blood meal in order to lay eggs. So only the females are drinking blood, and they're only drinking it in order to get the nutrients they need to lay eggs. Most of the time, most mosquitoes are going to be eating other things. Fruit, I have to actually go through and figure out what most of them eat. But they're not really bloodivores, hemophores. So anyway, eliminating them from the ecosystem is a concern because there are some species that seem to depend, particularly on the larva in freshwater fish and so on. But on the balance, eliminating so much disease versus the ecological damage, some people argue that's still worth it.
An argument could at the very least be made for controlled culling. Because I know at least one of the methods for the potential eradication of mosquitoes is genetically modifying them so that after one generation they become sterile.
That's right.
I can't remember the name of the genome because it's sciencey and I'm not drunk enough to remember, but it's basically you change the genome of one generation, let them loose, the next generation doesn't have what it needs to get the job done, and just boom, generation gone. While I wouldn't say for sure you could do that all over the world and do it constantly to every species, an argument could very simply be made for, well, just do it in places that are constantly being hit by these diseases, mm-hmm. where it's really, really badly needed.
Oxitec is doing that now with the sterile male mosquito. And that's one reason why their mosquitoes can't possibly be responsible for the Zika outbreak, because male mosquitoes don't bite.
Yeah, that's what you would say, you shill.
What you guys are thinking of is called a gene drive, and it's a way of making sure that a particular transgene is transmitted, even if it has sort of a deleterious or harmful effect to the species as a whole. And there's a lot of work going on. There's a lot of money going on. We mentioned maybe before the show started about Bill Gates, and the Bill Gates Foundation are funding gene drives for mosquitoes. So that might be where that particular conspiracy theory comes from, that this is all part of his depopulation of Earth agenda. But he is actually funding some gene drive research to see if it can be done.
Oh, the simple response I always give to people that say, oh, he's trying to depopulate the Earth, is no. He's trying to infect us all so we'll buy Windows instead of
I always wanted to know
what more money would mean to him at this point.
Yeah, but to be fair, it's brilliant to see the little wheels turn in the conspiracy theories.
I think Windows 10 is just as much a conspiracy theory.
Yeah.
Keeps popping up and asking me.
I think it's always been like, Windows Vista and 8. There has to be a conspiracy there just to explain how shit they were.
Okay. <Yeah. coughs> Sorry, excuse me. I do believe, Concordance, you were saying you're going to have to duck out in a few minutes. Sorry, excuse me. So I think we can just start to wrap it up. It's a little bit earlier than, but we'll, to let you get away. As always, we'll go around the panel for your final thoughts. Kitch.
I only caught the last 20 minutes or so, but it was really interesting when I was here. I did learn a good few things, especially about the mosquitoes. That was actually quite interesting. Just thanks for coming on and sparing the time to appear on the show. Thanks a million.
All Alright, Pumpkin.
I'm guessing I probably should have taken this whole thing more seriously and made less shit joke, but it was interesting talking with you, and I think it's also very interesting that we can see Cal succumb to the Zika virus live on cam. It's definitely invigorating.
You guys experimentally infected Cal on live while I wasn't here.
Yeah, control, they've got a drone mosquito the remote control to my place. Nathan.
It's like Ant-Man, but with mosquitoes. Much less popular.
Yeah, thanks for coming on. It was interesting, and I learned a lot, as I always do watching your stuff, or because I've seen most of your videos, and it's been an educational experience for me, and I appreciate it.
Okay, and Marty?
Yeah, thanks for coming on the show. I wish I could say it was interesting, but I'm not interested in this stuff, so sorry about that. Like I keep saying, I don't know anything about this stuff, but I do have one quick question to ask you. You made a video to Jordan of Spirit Science, and you took your standard approach where you were really polite to him. And I got to ask you, did he ever contact you in any way?
No, but someone was on that video recently and commented that they had reached Jordan. And that Jordan did see the video, he did think about it, but what he said was that he doesn't think the science is currently there to test his ideas. He says maybe in the future, when science has progressed to understand more about spirituality, that then we can readdress the question and test whether or not, you know, Jews are from space or any of those other theories. But I liked his I liked the idea that he at least thought about it, which is really, I mean, honestly, guys, what do you expect? It's like...
No, I didn't expect him to get back at you in any way at all.
Yeah, and I didn't really either, except that I thought maybe some of the people watch his videos would think about the idea of, can we test the ideas that he comes up with? And he's saying right now, no, that science is the wrong tool to analyze the ideas he's advancing.
Which is why he's calling his ideas science.
Yeah, spirit science.
Oh no, I think it's the problem he's having is that science is by definition a bullshit detector, and he can't go near it without it fucking setting off at 100 decibels.
You know what? And this is the point of that video. It's interesting to get negative results. It's not always publishable. It's not always great for your career. But to find out that something isn't true is still a type of knowledge. You don't have to accept it. You can continue to believe whatever you want to believe. Like, it's pretty much what denialism is. But finding out something's not true is sometimes just as interesting, and finding ways to test it is sometimes very interesting. So I'm not being facetious. I am interested in testing any of the ideas that he is putting forward. And I think everyone would get something out of it in sort of thinking a little bit harder about, you know, are these ideas even taking risks and making predictions?
The problem is they're not.
They're not. Mm-hmm. They're unfalsifiable.
Yeah. Okay.
They're not even.
Okay. Thank you.
Just to finish off, Concordance, if people want to reach you, you can let them know now. A wee soapbox moment for you.
You can follow me on Twitter. You can check me out on YouTube. I've got, I don't know, a ton of videos. I haven't updated in a long time because work is very busy, but I will get back to it. I've got a couple of topics I'm looking at.
Oh, yeah,
if you want to find out more about what I'm about.
There's been a few demands from the chat room that you make more videos.
All right, I'll work on it.
All right, and with that, thank you everyone for turning out. Give a big thumbs up to Concordance for taking the time out, and we're back in 2 weeks. Our special guest is a guy, Brian Scott. He runs the Farmer's Life Facebook page, and we're interviewing him because he's actually a farmer who's dealt with Monsanto, so it kind of completes the series of people we've interviewed on the whole Monsanto thing. We've gone from the scientists to Vance, the publicist, and then we're going to hear about it at the farmer's end. So, yeah, like I said, that'll hopefully give everyone a really good overview of what Monsanto's all about from the lab all the way to the farm. And with that, I just wish everyone good rest of the weekend and take care wherever you are. Have a good one. Bye.
Bye, Al.
Bye. Have fun.
Bye, everybody. It's hip to be a hipster. Cool to be a hipster. Shit if you're not hipster. So hit.